Thank you very much for having me here. It's very nice to visit Manchester for the first time. I thought I'd show you, it's been almost exactly 3 years since I've worked at MIT working on Julia, and I thought I'd share some of the things I've learned from this. And what I won't show is probably any Julia code, surprisingly enough. So here's what the lab looks like today. So the people on the top half, the first 2.5 rows, these are the people who have worked specifically at MIT in the last 3 years to bring Julia to what it is today. We also have many collaborators at MIT. I've only had space to squeeze in just the ones at MIT and in the Boston area. There's a whole bunch of these other ones here. These are the people who gave us money, for which we're very grateful. If you want to know how to create a new programming language, step one is convince other people to pay for it. I thought I'd also point out that this happened today. In the last 24 hours, Julia 0.5 was just tagged, and we might be releasing binaries today, assuming this gets merged. It's very tempting to just go like that. Yeah, that's right. You can just go to the URL over here. I turned off the internet because I didn't want random things to show up on my screen. Anyway. There are also people who have participated in open source developments. One of the big programs that we participated in is Google Sum of Code. And we've been fairly successful at keeping some of these Google Sum of Code people around to keep working on Julia. So in particular, we see Keno, Simon, Shashi, Mike Innes, and Jared, and bunch of other people. I didn't update this for 2016. Oops. Anyway, a lot of them ended up at Julia Computing or in the lab somehow, or at least active in the space. We're very happy to have these people around. If anyone had any doubts as to whether or not people use Julia, this is a somewhat out of date, half a year old list of the number of people who have made contributions to Julia. 445 people have contributed to Julia as of March 2016, and 726 people have written a package or committed or contributed to a package. And this is where they all are. This script used to run, this is a Julia script that downloads all this GitHub data of people who have been contributing to Julia and tries to figure out their geolocation based on their self-reported location on GitHub and then place them on a map roughly sized according to the number of commits they have. So all the people in red are developers, and there are people who watch but not stargazers, and the people who stargaze and have contributed in some way no longer fit on this map. So that probably says a bit. Let's see. So here's my life story. This did not animate the way I wanted, but anyway. So I started life out here in Singapore, over there. Stayed there until I was an undergraduate and went to Illinois, over there on the other side of the world. And I went back to work in the National Lab in Singapore. I worked on making explosives, so making things blow up with lasers. So I also had to figure out how to make the laser talk to Microsoft Excel, which was the state-of-the-art data analysis software back in 2003. I decided that I didn't want to do that anymore, went back to Illinois, worked on computational chemistry, stayed for my postdoc at MIT, worked on solar energy, and then since 2013 have been working on Julia. So if you're wondering who this person is standing in front of you, this is what I've done with my life so far. And here's us today. Oh wait, that's the wrong one. That one. Yeah. All right. Good. All right. So, all right. That's the point today, I guess, is to bring some of Julia's knowledge over here, and I was playing with animations. This was fun. Here's my life story in a different way. So, if you look at all the is there a way to turn the lights down? It seems. Can people actually see this? All right. I'll pretend for now that people can see this. So I decided I would go back and go through all the different programming languages I've used for work or for school at some point. And I started out with BASIC and Logo and Pascal in school, and then later on went to C and C++. When I was in the National Lab, I worked with LabVIEW and I worked with Visual Basic and MATLAB, but the second year I was there, they actually forgot to buy a new license for MATLAB, and so we couldn't use MATLAB anymore, so we had to switch to Octave. So that was life in Singapore. When I was in Illinois, it was MATLAB and Python, and there was C and C++ and Fortran because I was working in computational chemistry, and a lot of the codes in this area are very old and very complicated, and there are these horrible mishmashes of Fortran, C, and C++, a story you've probably heard many times in many different disciplines. And then I started working on Julia in the last couple of years. And I think the list of languages that I've experienced, they really fall into this really nice dichotomy here. There are the slow languages that are fun, that are easy to write prototypes in. And then there are the fast languages that actually do all the heavy lifting when you actually want to run calculations. And this phenomenon where you make experiments in one language, but it's too slow to run, and therefore you have to actually rewrite the whole thing in a different language. It's called the two-language problem, and Julia is a potential solution to that, at least in the scientific computing space. So I thought, as an homage to Manchester, that I'd look up some early history of computing, and this might be a bit too small for this room, but in 1948, when the Manchester Baby was first run, you may remember from yesterday that the Manchester Baby was the first electronic computer that ran a stored computer program. And also, it was the first modern computer that had RAM. So really interesting what you think like computing must have been like when you didn't have RAM. Okay. Who was contemporary at this point? There was a group at Harvard that had a computer that was electromechanical, so it actually ran on gears and electrical wires. There's ENIAC at Pennsylvania, and there was actually this little thing in Iowa called the Atanasoff Berry computer. And it was hard-coded, it didn't run a stored program, but it was the first electronic computer to solve a linear system of equations of size 29 by 29. And this ran for exactly 6 months until I think it was Atanasoff who graduated, and then the computer broke. So a story we've heard before since 1942. The Colossus and all the work at Bletchley Park had just wound down a few years before, and there's Konrad Zuse in Berlin who had worked on a bunch of computers called the Z1, Z2, Z3, Z4, the first three of which were destroyed by World War II bombings. And there was also EDSEC, which was just about to come online in Cambridge, Cambridge, UK at least. And this is a world of four electrified computers. Think about what computing must have been like in this universe. This is what was yet to come. In the world. So this was before the Lanczos iteration was invented, for those of you who know what that is. There were a bunch of other machines about to come online. This was before the for loop was invented. This was before the first modern language was invented. Fortran had just barely come out. So imagine what that was like, life without programming languages or on compilers. And I'll just leave this up there and go very quickly to mention that another landmark that happened in Manchester that was perhaps slightly less well known is that arguably the first compiled language was invented and run in 1952 here on the Manchester Mark I. And this was a language that was called AutoCode. And AutoCode is a cross between sort of assembler and a compiler. It's kind of interesting. So if you take all the hardware away, this is what life looked like when you fast forward a couple of years to 1955. So 1955 is remarkable because it was on the onset of Fortran, which is the first language that was born that we still use today, over here at IBM in New York. Al Gore and its predecessor was just on the cusp of being developed in 1958. And you see here that there's a little bit of a thought that, you know, you shouldn't code by punching binary numbers or, you know, random typewriter symbols into some input tape and you feed it to the machine. Maybe you wanted to organize things into some sort of representation that was like a mathematical formula. And so this was the age of computing in 1955. A lot of the concepts we think about in programming languages date to this time and haven't changed since. It's really interesting. So I took this from a very famous website in the US. They have a slogan that says, if you see something, say something. But what does it really mean to say something? Anyone care to guess where I'm going with this? So I'm trying to get to this concept of linguistic relativity. Has anyone heard of linguistic relativity? The Sapir-Whorf hypothesis? Would you like to tell me what it is? Oh, is there a microphone here? That's all right. All I wanted to get to, sorry to embarrass you so early in the morning, but what I was getting at was that linguistic relativity is this idea that the languages you speak determine how you think about the world. And so depending on exactly which variant you look at, it's the fact that language determines or constrains how you think about the universe. And this is a somewhat famous hypothesis, but I thought it was fun to go back to the original text and ask, what did these people actually write, given that these two people, Sapir and Wolf, have their name attached to this? I'll just read a couple of things. So human beings are very much at the mercy of the particular language which has become the medium of expression for the society. Furthermore, the real world is to a large extent unconsciously built up on the language habits of the group. So this is what Edward Sapir wrote, and here's what Wolf wrote. So every person carries through life certain naive but deeply rooted ideas about talking and its relation to thinking. Because of their firm connection with speech habits that become unconscious and automatic, these notions tend to be rather intolerant of opposition. So where I'm going with this is that Sapir and Whorf wrote about human languages, so English, Western languages, and particularly at the time in the early 20th century, how this contrasted with indigenous languages in North America. But I think a lot of the words that they've written here are very much applicable to programming languages. Here's another cute one. Alienness turns into a new and often clarifying way of looking at things. Come back to this. So language, in my mind, this is the real statement of the Sapir-Whorf hypothesis, in their words, that language shapes the formation of naive and deep-rooted and unconscious cultural habits that resist opposition. And to what extent is this also true of programming languages? So I thought I'd ask today, how many people here use MATLAB? Okay, just about everyone. Anyone use Python? R? C? Fortran? APL? Oh, okay, no APL people. Okay, great. So here's the stereotypical data science task. I think if there's anything that passes for data science, it would be a question that looks like this. So imagine I work for Uber, and this is a particular Uber driver, and this is a record of the last 5 ratings for the last 10 ratings for the last 10 trips that he's taken. And you see that there are a couple of different people, some of the people have taken multiple trips with this driver, and I want to find the average rating each user has given to the driver. So I think this is a very stereotypical task. Anyone want to shout out what this is kind of problem is? Anyone? Any of the R people recognize this? What would you do in R? Anyone? So, yeah, sure. Okay. So, yes, that is the problem. So, I guess it's fine. The thing I wanted to get at was that in R there's the standard idiom for doing this problem, and it really is a summarize and group by. So these are the two things that you would type into R to actually get the answer that you wanted. And so the group by aggregates by user ID, and then the reduction is applied with the mean. And that's the answer you get here. And turns out there's a MATLAB function that does exactly this problem. And I know it's early in the morning, I'll stop pestering you. The magic function that does this is a QM array, and this is how you spell this particular operation. So you input these as vectors, you transpose them, and then you take, you specify the mean function pointer, and you get this sparse matrix as the result. And if you don't pass true as the last argument to a QM array, this is not a sparse matrix. Instead, it's a dense matrix of 193,942 by 1, with most of the entries 0, and a bunch of these actually have the ratings you want. And so APL, I will just show. This is actual code in a language called APL. The solution I came up with involves finding this V matrix, which is an indicator matrix explaining how exactly each unique ID shows up in which entries. And then that's a binary matrix of zeros and ones, which you can then use to do a matrix vector product that calculates the sum, and then you can divide by the mean, and so on. And so this gets you the answer. And the point being that in APL, everything is an array, and everything you're supposed to do in APL is some sort of matrix product. And so this is one way, at least, to specify what a matrix product looks like and how this problem may be expressed in terms of entirely in terms of linear algebra. Furthermore, this is how you define a function in APL. Take that for what it is. Right. So what have I tried to show here? I tried to show that the same problem can be attacked in very different ways in what people would consider idiomatic in these languages. And the solutions all involve different ideas. So in R, you would use dplyr to create a new data frame, and there's some sort of canonical ideas of transformations of these data frames that are involved. In MATLAB, you have a higher order function that maps matrices into other matrices. And in APL, you're stuck with matrix products of various forms. And the abstractions that you use are very different. You have data frames in R, you have matrices in MATLAB, and APL gives you really just arrays to work with. Here's what C looks like. You've probably seen this before. I'll skip this. But what does code actually mean? So let's go back to this idea of what is language and what is code. So if you had to write down what programming languages meant, you might write down things like what types of data are allowed in a language, how do you evaluate an expression in this language, how is code organized, how do you decide what to do in this language, and so on and so forth. So you can think of aggregations of these sorts of characteristics. And for each of these, you can come up with a list of things you might want in this language. For example, data, you might want floating point numbers, you might want integer numbers, you might want user-defined data, and so on and so forth. But I was focused just on just these bits, specifically code being organized into functions and how to decide what to do in terms of method dispatch. So multiple dispatch is a term you may have heard many, many times with Julia. And I like to think of it as Julia's way of expressing what polymorphism means in mathematics. And just to take a very simple example, if you ask what A times B meant, I think all of you in this room already have a polymorphic understanding of what A times B means. Because it could mean multiplying two whole numbers together, which is how I learned how to multiply, and probably how most of you learned how to multiply. You start with whole numbers. And then later on in your mathematics career, you may decide that you may want to learn how to multiply complex numbers, which is a completely different way to multiply. You may decide to multiply fractions. Fractions are also a different kind of number. And then you go on to things like matrices. Matrices are a completely different kind of mathematical objects. And still you think about multiplying matrix times matrix together. And in Julia, we also use this for string concatenation, which is yet another different meaning that in some sense is a product. So Julia is object-oriented, but not necessarily in the way that you've been taught in school. And most people who know the phrase object-oriented programming come to it by way of classes and in a very C++ type way. So the question of code organization can be broken down as, what things do I want? What do I want to do with them? So here's an example that I had from a subway card in London. This is an Oyster card. So here are a bunch of things you can do with them. So you can buy one, and you can add value to it, and you can pay your fare with it. And if you're like me, you lose them every year or so you lose them as well. So that's an object. That's a subway card. That's a bunch of things you can do with the subway card. Here's the exact same card in Boston. You can do the same things with them. And here's one from a different country. It's not quite the same. So the thing you can't do is you can't add value to this thing. It's a single-use ticket. And so this gives you this notion of what classes are. Classes are these objects that may contain internal structure, but these are the only ways you're allowed to interact with it. And the idea is that the object is the primary thing in a class-based description, and the methods, the words, what you do with them, are in some sense auxiliary or secondary in describing the behavior of these things. That's what I just said. So with multi-methods and generic functions, the idea is that buy is a common feature, is a common action you want to do on them, and so is losing them, so is paying your fare. So you can actually group all the different values together, and those things become generic functions. And so multi-methods is the fact that you have many multiple connections between the verbs and the nouns, if you want to think about it that way. It's about relationships. You can make hierarchies with them. You can try to organize the code in ways. And you can think of them saying that once I have structure and organization, that there actually is certain kinds of verbs I want to associate with these abstract concepts, which in some sense are divorced from the actual implementation in terms of exactly which card I have at any one time. So going back to this, the meaning of A times B really depends on context. It depends on what A and B are. And so if you, here are three different ways to do it. So you could imagine that if you opened up the source code of MATLAB, which I don't recommend unless you really have to, that you might see something like this on the left side. You would see a giant if statement that says, if A is a number and B is a number, do this. Otherwise, if A is a number and B is a matrix, do this. Otherwise, if A is a matrix and B is a matrix, do this. And so on and so forth. And so this is how you would implement the multiple meanings of multiply. If you had to open up the definition of what A times B meant, it would mean something like this in MATLAB. In something like C++, you would have something like this, where you would have classes. You have a number class, you have a matrix class, and then each class knows how to interact with itself and with other classes, and there are other things you can do with them, but that's what all the multiplies go. And in the generic function model of object-orientedness, you would have a generic function. It's just multiply. That's the star function. And then you have specialized methods for going number times number means this, and number times matrix means this, and so on and so forth. Now, the interesting thing is what happens when you try to extend this. So let's say I work in general relativity, and I'm interested in spinors, which are a particular kind of mathematical object. So now I want to introduce this new thing into my language. What do I do? In C++, I would create a spinor class, and the spinor has to interact with maybe all these other things that I care about. But the interesting thing here is that now it doesn't always work that way, right? So there are some things I want to do. Maybe I want to do matrix times spinor, but in C++, you can't dispatch on the second thing that you've created. So you need to actually go and edit the number class and the matrix class to teach it about spinors, and say, to do this with a spinner, you need to be able to do this. And in some sense, this breaks this notion of encapsulation that exists with classes. With a generic function method, encapsulation is not a big deal, and all you have to do is just define the new methods. They just go under the new methods to define multiply. And then you can, of course, just edit the if statement to add more branches and so on and so forth. So the point is not that there are things you can do in one paradigm and not the other. The point is just that they're different, and this actually influences how you think and organize about code. And this is how many ways in 0.4, at least, these are the different ways that Julia knows how to multiply. There are 138 different ways. And so I think if I had to summarize how Julia can be fast and composable at the same time, it really is this, that you can define multiple meanings of to do things, many ways to multiply, many ways to do the same thing, the same function, can have multiple methods. But if you can write your code in such a way that the compiler can figure out exactly which definition you wanted, then it can generalize optimized code, and that will run fast. So some frequently asked questions. Why is it called Julia? As far as I can tell, it's a nice name, and that's it. Right. Is Julia compiled or interpreted? It's both, and the real reason for this is that the distinction between compiled and interpreted languages really went away sometime in the 1990s. So if you're like me and was taught by an old-fashioned teacher, you might remember that the universe of programming languages can be classified into compiled and interpreted languages. So in a compiled language, you have to write the source code, you run it through a compiler, then you produce a binary, and then you run the binary. And then in a dynamic language, you would just have a script, and it just gets interpreted. And these days, there are lots and lots of variations on this theme. But the one that's relevant to us in Julia is that you can also try to compile it as you read the code in. So you can imagine essentially inserting a compilation step to figure out what you want. And this compiler is the thing that lets you is the thing that would do what's on the previous slide here. So this gives you a stage at which you can try to figure out exactly what's happening in the code. Here. And so when I gave this talk 2 years ago at SIAM in Utah, had a very distinguished guest in the audience whose name was Cleve Moeller. And he stood up halfway through this at this point, and he stood up and said that MATLAB has a JIT too, and I wanted everyone to know that. And now what happened was that I had actually prepared some numbers showing what happens when you turn the JIT off in MATLAB. So, and that's the result. If you turn the JIT off for this, this is one data point for one algorithm that we've tried, and turning the JIT off in MATLAB made it slower. So it made it faster. So then by default, if you leave the JIT on in MATLAB, it actually runs slower than if you just turn the JIT off in the first place. Yes, of course. So this is just the one data point. Yes. Well, so MATLAB's JIT prior to 2014 actually did a terrible job with for loops. Yes. So I will say that if you want to reproduce this test for yourself, that MATLAB 2015B has an entirely new JIT engine underneath. And we noticed because we ran the numbers for 2015B when we released Julia 0.4, and then suddenly there was like across the board like tenfold improvement in a bunch of things. So MATLAB, for example, the for loops went from something like 7,000 times slower than Julia to about 800 times slower than Julia. So, you know, tenfold improvement is still pretty good, right? So take these numbers for what they are. Why can't you just make MATLAB or R or Python or all these other languages faster? It's a question that happens all the time. Others have tried and with limited success. And the very short answer to this is that these languages have features that are very hard for compilers to understand. And hopefully what I've just talked about for the last half an hour will give you a thought about why. And it really is important that you design languages with features that are easy to analyze, just as it is important for a language to have features that are easy for humans to use. And there's lots of ongoing work in this area. I'll just point it out. And let's see. Well, I thought that was all I had to say, but I can say a little bit about linear algebra if people want to hear about it. I will tell you a little bit, I guess, about genomics data and showing that Julia can be used for real work. So here's something that we've been looking at in the last year or so with a group at Harvard Medical School. It's a kind of study called GWAS, Genome-Wide Association Studies. And here's a very, very oversimplified description of what it is. So the idea is that you want to be able to predict disease outcomes. So imagine if you're interested in multiple sclerosis, which is one of these very complicated medical conditions, and you want to figure out if the patient will react positively or negatively to some treatment. And what you could do is imagine that I want to look at this person's characteristics in reference to everyone else I know. Maybe I'm a hospital network and I know other people's records. And I want to know that if you have this particular symptom, maybe you've had this adverse reaction to a previous test, that therefore this is correlated with maybe adverse reaction in some other treatment that we will give you. In GWAS studies, the data that you look specifically at would be genomics data. And this will be literally your entire human genome and how many mutations of a certain type at a certain position you have relative to some reference person. And so the matrix you put in here simply counts the number of mutations you have. And this becomes a regression problem. You're trying to predict outcomes that can be coded as 1 or 0, you know, patient responded favorably or otherwise. And the input here would be, on the X side, would be the data that is just the number of mutations you have. And the idea is that maybe you have some rare mutation that is somehow correlated with the disease outcome. So sources of noise in this problem, I'll focus on just one, which is the population stratification. And this is a fancy word for saying that because there are different subpopulations in the human race, there are, you know, that Asian populations have black eyes and Scandinavians have blonde hair and so on and so forth. These are all variations that exist in the data, which we don't think are relevant for a disease state. The other two that are very important, but I will just skip over this. In linear algebra terms, really what we're looking for is low rank structure in the data with large variance. This is what Julia code looks like, I guess. I lied when I said I won't show you any Julia code. So if you go look at a particular algorithm that you might find in a numerical textbook, you might see it written in this form, which is actually derived from ALGOL. So this is actually some sort of corrupted ALGOL. And this is what it looks like in Julia. This is a fully working implementation. You can type this into Julia terminal, and this will work. And those of you who were here yesterday, you'll know that we can do cute things like put Greek symbols into code, and that gives you a nice correspondence between the published version of an algorithm and what you would see in working code. And those of you who have worked on Lanchos know that if you actually run this, it doesn't work, and then you'll be very sad. So you'll skip that. The main problem with Lanchos methods is a very well-known one, which is essentially round off error. And furthermore, the growth in round off error results in loss of orthogonality, and this happens especially when you converge to the exact solution. And every practical implementation of Lanchos has to reinforce orthogonality with as little cost as possible so that it's still practical to run. There are many, many different strategies you could want. And the thing is that oftentimes when you go look at the software implementations, there'll be some library that does this strategy, and this other program does this other strategy, and so on and so forth. And it's just very hard to experiment with mixing and matching features. You're stuck with what's available out there. So if you wanted some arbitrary combination of these things, you simply couldn't do it, and you have to basically roll your own. You can't do this in Julia today anyway, but you can start doing things with that will get you there. So for example, you can do things like LU factorizations on high-precision quaternions. All you have to do is define a quaternion class and how to turn it into a high-precision quaternion, and then this LU factorization will simply work and give you this horrendously large number, and so on and so forth. Writing generic code really is about just writing the code you want. You want to write A times B, you want to write A minus B, and so on and so forth, and then you just define the algebra that you want as the interface, and you've seen how we can simply extend times and minus and so on in Julia. These are just names of functions, and these can just be new definitions for what you need to do. And this code will work for any combination of types for which these particular operations are defined. And let's see. So you can do this, it will work. So if you go back to the genomics data, I have 5 minutes, so I will go through very quickly. It turns out that the genomics data has a singular spectrum that looks like this. You'll see that the first 5 or 6 singular vectors have very high strength. The singular values are very high. And then the rest of them essentially follow a random matrix law known as the Marchenko-Pasteur law. And this is the dashed line in red. If you plot what the density of the singular values look like, it looks like this. So that's the bulk behavior, which is the part that behaves like Marchenko-Pasteur, which is the description of entirely random data. And then you have a bunch of these outlying components. We think this works well for Lanchos methods. Let me skip this. But what I wanted to show is that a method like Flash PCA, which is what a lot of the genomics people use, is essentially block power iterations, or subspace iteration. And it suffers from loss of orthogonality, at least in the published version. And by playing around with this, we can see that if you implemented a proper Lanchos method, that you get this very nice onion peeling behavior that you can find in textbooks about Lanchos. That you see that this, you have this very rapid convergence of the top few singular values, and then this and the rest of these converge fairly slowly. And in a very interesting way, and this is, I think, interesting partly because we're able to see it. If you wanted to do this particular calculation in a Fortran code, it would be very hard-pressed to pull out all these numbers. But you can pull out the error bars, which is something that you can do if you have the code to play with. And you can see that there's different convergence rates, and they can use that to inform decisions about how you might want to refine your code further. And I think really that's... So I guess this is the last bit I'll present, which is that our method is significantly faster and it works better, and we can prove that it has high precision. And this is the kind of thing that you could do in Julia, part of the reason because it's easy to extend the base language of Julia to define methods for what you want, and also be able to adapt the same program that you've just written for many different cases. You can use the same thing to run parallel computations if you like. You can do this for crazy numeric types if you like, and so on and so forth. And I think I'll leave it here for now. And thank you very much. I hope this was this was not too much. But thanks for your time. You can. That was the main motivation when we implemented this. So if you recall from yesterday, you can do backslash alpha and you press tab, and there's a list of these in the manual. There's a list out there of canonical names for symbols, and we simply adapted that into Julia. We have emoji.
Yeah.
Well, so this started as an April Fool's joke, and so you can do things like, I think, plus one. Is it plus one? Yeah. So emojis have names, and they're enclosed in double colons like this, and you press tab, and then it comes thumbs up, and you can assign it to the value of 34 or something like that. Right. So that works in Julia. So, and you can do Chinese if you like. We don't discriminate.
Is it like Unicode type?
Well, so that's the name of a variable now. So thumbs up is now a defined variable.
Okay.
Yeah. Yeah. So and this, because it's encoded in Unicode, that this is an allowed an identifier.
Sure.
Yeah. Yes.
I'm actually really interested in the last part of the talk where you showed the GWAS.
Mm-hmm.
Has that code been published? How far is that project into? Because I'd be interested in sort of trying out on some of our wheat data, because we've got some challenging genomes. That
okay. Well, so let's talk offline, but the short answer is we submitted this to Siam, and we presented this at the Siam special session on iterative methods at Copper Mountain in March. Paper's under review, and the code's out there in some form. If you look at iterative solvers, you'll find an implementation of this method there.
Well,